Hey guys, Bill Spadea here, back for our speaking podcast. I'd like to welcome back a pretty smart guy. His name is Dr. Jonathan Lesser. He is an adjunct fellow at the Manhattan Institute, and he's an expert on energy, the economy, and he has been one of the smart minds behind the great folks at Affordable Energy New Jersey as we fight for sensible energy policy in New Jersey, energy policy that reflects fact, not fiction, energy policy that makes energy affordable for the average person. Doc, welcome back to the speaking.
Thanks, Bill. I appreciate you having me on again.
So let's jump right into it. You and I were talking offline for a second about this study that came out of Rutgers University, and I'm going to do my best not to talk about the $1 billion taxpayer subsidy that goes to Rutgers every single year that I think should be redlined out of the budget. I'm going to try not to get on a tangent with that, but taxpayers are paying for this stuff, and they came out with a study saying that the sea levels are going to rise to a dangerous level over the next few decades, to the point where New Jerseyans should actually pay higher taxes to mitigate this. Let's first start with the premise of their discussion. You've read the report. We have history of sea level changes going back, you know, in recent history, at least 100 years. What do you say about what was presented by Rutgers regarding sea level rise?
Well, I mean, if you look at the actual sea level data, it's been going up at an average of, you know, 2 to 3 millimeters per year for the last 100 years. Now, there's no evidence that it suddenly accelerated. Nothing's really changed. So if you go out another century, at 3 millimeters a year for a century, that's 300 millimeters. That's basically, if I'm doing math in my head correctly, about 8 or 10 inches, something like that. So when they talk about sea level rise going up several feet or more in the next few decades, I simply don't know what that's based on in terms of, you know, compared to the actual evidence.
Now, they say it's based on satellite recordings and data where they've extrapolated 2.4 millimeter rise to a 3 millimeter rise, saying that 0.6 represents a 25% increase. So therefore, if you take that out over time, all of a sudden you get to 5 feet. Have we ever seen anything like that happen in not only the past 100 years, but just speaking to the climate? It seems that the coastlines are still pretty much intact the same way they have been for 1,000 years.
Well, I mean, you can go back to the Ice Age when the sea level levels were hundreds of feet lower because all that water was in glaciers that were, for example, Manhattan was covered with a glacier a mile thick 10,000 years ago. So, yeah, sea levels can rise a lot. But you're getting, you know, some of the observed increase is due to the ground actually dropping, because you pump water out of the ground and the ground subsides. So, you know, that's happening in some cities. They just extract groundwater. And so, you know, the ground slowly falls, and hence you see sea level rising. But again, I just don't, you know, I'm not a climate scientist. I don't see it. Looking at the data, where's the sudden change that the Rutgers study must be predicting that says sea level will increase several feet over the next couple decades? That's just, I just don't get it.
So let's say, worst case scenario, and we've had this conversation, you know, as far as the human contribution to, because it's easy for a simple mind of someone that doesn't have the depth of knowledge that you have to hear, well, glaciers hold the water, the glaciers melt, the water's going to rise, obviously we'll be flooded. So let's now take the other side. Instead of raising taxes on people and relocating everyone in this panic, we want to have a clean atmosphere. And I haven't met anybody on the conservative side or the liberal side yet that is in favor of pollution. I think most people are pretty much in favor of clean water and clean air.
Sure.
But, you know, with your work with the Manhattan Institute, your work with Affordable Energy New Jersey, we've had some of the cleanest air in a century in America, and certainly in the Northeast, when it comes to what we've done with natural gas and nuclear. So can you speak to where are we as far as our environment, and how much of the changes that could take place under all these measures being proposed under the governor's master energy plan, how much would that even impact climate if we accepted that human behavior was a big part of it?
Well, if you, New Jersey, the New Jersey has an emissions inventory. And I think the last study the state did was for the year 2019. And they said that total greenhouse gas emissions or carbon emissions were about 98 million tons. That sounds like a whole lot. But the world carbon emissions, according to the BP World Energy Statistics publication in 2019, were 35 billion tons, billion with a B. So if New Jersey somehow tomorrow could eliminate all of its carbon emissions, it would be the equivalent of less than one day's worth of world CO2 emissions. It simply doesn't, it's not going to have any impact on climate whatsoever. The other thing that's interesting, it's, you know, I've got a report coming out on the electric vehicle mandates that are part of the Energy Master Plan. And if you look at that, and you compare, New Jersey gets its electricity from something called PJM, which is a 14 state consortium that operates all the high voltage transmission lines and about 1400 power plants. And it coordinates all those operations to make sure electricity is reliable and as cost effective as possible. So when somebody from New Jersey, you know, switches on a light, they're getting electricity from PJM. They may think it's coming from, you know, that wind turbine offshore, a solar cell, you know, up the road, but it's not. It's really all just part of the grid. So what I looked at is what happens when you compare an electric vehicle, which pollutes via the electricity, and versus a new internal combustion vehicle. And what I found was that the comparison was based on PJM's emissions in 2019, especially at night when you'd normally be charging most electric vehicles, the sulfur dioxide emissions would increase by a factor of 50. That's 50, because gasoline has almost no sulfur, but in PJM, you've got coal plants, natural gas plants, they all emit some sulfur dioxide. NOx emissions, another thing that's in an air pollutant that affects health, would increase by three times. Particulate emissions, even an advocate, Charge EVC, which is advocating a complete changeover to electric vehicles for the state, admitted that particulate emissions would go up. Now, I couldn't calculate those because PJM doesn't release particulate emissions data.
Wait, what was the, Doc, what was the second one after sulfur dioxide?
Oxides of nitrogen, otherwise known as NOx.
MOX?
NOx, N-O-X. And, you know, NOx will form ozone, ground level ozone, and that has supposedly health impact.
Got it.
So the people who are going to be charging their EVs, for the most part, are going to be causing more pollution to be emitted. Now, granted, it won't be emitted out the tailpipe on the street, but instead what you'll get is pollution emitted from plants west of New Jersey. And as you probably know, the prevailing winds are from west to east. So the pollution just comes back and gets dumped on New Jersey anyway. So, and as for the carbon emissions, I did a calculation. If you replaced all if you had all the electric vehicles and somehow they were all powered with absolute emissions-free electricity, and I'm just looking up the number, the carbon emission savings would amount to between 2021 and 2035, 2021, this year, And 2035, the state's calling for 2 million electric vehicles to be on the road by 2035. Let's suppose that all the electricity was perfectly clean, emissions free. In that 14, 15 year period, the CO2 savings would be the equivalent of 11 hours worth of emissions, world CO2 emissions in 2019. So the idea that say an EV mandate or a mandate, New Jersey's mandate for zero carbon by 2050 is gonna somehow save the climate, which apparently is the primary reason for the EMP, is just nonsensical. It's not, the emissions reduction is minuscule.
So let's talk about that. You know, I think that's one of the things where I read a great article, I may have mentioned it last time, in defense of CO2, Dr. William Happer at Princeton University wrote a really thoughtful piece. You had mentioned something, I think, in our conversation last time about that you know, carbon dioxide is not, CO2 is not a pollutant. And I think there's a growing number of people that are educated with what many of us call propaganda in our schools, our secondary schools, our primary schools, where the kids are taught that these natural emissions are poison and CO2 is a poison. So therefore, the minute you start talking about carbon emissions, immediately people start equating that with something horrible. Can you address that and put it in simple terms for just the average person to say when they're at the dinner party, they're like, well, you know, the CO2 pollution is horrible. We got to do everything we can to stop it. What would you say to that?
Well, if there was no carbon dioxide, life on this planet wouldn't exist, or at least most of it wouldn't. I'm sure some stuff under the sea, you know, bacteria that eats sulfur or whatever, 30,000 feet below the surface, would exist. But plants, once CO2 levels drop to less than 150 parts per million, plants die. And in the last glacial age, CO2 levels actually fell to about 180. So it was close to the point where plants could no longer survive. So CO2 is not a pollutant. It's necessary for life. I mean, plants use CO2. That's what they basically feed on. They take in carbon dioxide and they spit out oxygen. So to think that CO2 is a pollutant that is somehow killing us and it's poisonous to breathe, that's just simply not true. We couldn't live on this planet if there was no carbon dioxide.
So what do you say if you're in a debate, someone says to you, well, doc, that's all well and good. However, there are limits that NASA, the U.S. Navy put on CO2 levels for healthy exchange of oxygen for sailors and astronauts, et cetera. And they cap it somewhere around, I believe, the 5,000 parts per million level, maybe 3,000 at some level. But our rise, in the words of the panickers who all saw the inconvenient truth and took that as gospel and have now put 20 years of policy behind it, will say we went from 350 to 450. Now we're in danger of being at 500. Isn't it this rapid rise that could get us close to a ceiling that could kill us all? What do you say to that?
Well, I guess I would say that's nonsense. it's just... Again, yeah, current CO2 levels are around 450 parts per million. The other thing people probably don't know is greenhouses. They add carbon dioxide into, greenhouses to make plants grow faster. And those are at much higher levels, you know, like 1,000 parts per million. So, yeah, if you went and tried to breathe pure carbon dioxide, you would eventually die. Because we need oxygen. But to suggest that from the current levels, CO2 levels are going to go up to 5,000, 10,000, whatever, there's just no evidence for that at all. That's simply what they're doing is you take a trend and you extrapolate it forever. Here's an example of why that doesn't work. For many years, the average number of drivers in cars, or passengers and drivers in cars, was fall. Well, if, you know, from 3 down to 2 to 1.5, whatever. So if you extrapolated that data, you could show that, well, eventually the number of passenger people driving in a car is going to fall below 1. Well, that's not really possible because somebody's got to be driving. So just doing these linear extrapolations with, a, you know, taking a ruler and drawing a straight line forever, it doesn't make sense. You can't do that, because you end up with results that are nonsensical. And that's what a lot of these people, I believe, are doing. And I don't want to say that there's no impact on climate. You know, sure, man has an impact on the climate. Absolutely. You can see that, especially at the local level. And, you know, on broader levels, it's probably, you know, it's probably true that we have an impact on climate based on, you know, what we do in forestry practices, agriculture, all that. Sure, it obviously has an impact. But to suggest that it's going to be some catastrophic, you know, what is it, 8 years from now? I think it was 12 years in 2018. Now
I think AOC said we have 12 years left on the planet. That's it.
Yeah, but that was a few years ago. So
true. Fair enough.
You know, to think that, well, on April 7th, 2030, the world's going to come to an end at 2:45 p.m. That's just nonsense.
Do you, in your research and in your travels, is there a state or a nation that has gotten it right? I often use the example of France, where they put 80% of their grid is on nuclear power, so their emissions are very low. It's very modern. It's very reliable. And then you've got states across this country where, you know, we know, if not for the innovation of fracking and the expanse of that, I mean, you saw what the economy did in places like Pennsylvania and North Dakota during the boom over the past few years. Is there a state that has an energy policy or a country that you would say, okay, if New Jersey would just follow a couple of points from this policy, you could really have affordable energy, clean air for everyone?
Well, the states with the lowest cost electricity are actually the Pacific Northwest, because they have a lot of old federal hydropower. So you've got all the dams on the Columbia River. Well, we can't build those anymore. There really aren't any sites. So, you know, I think the other states that are relying heavily on natural gas, states that have nuclear, I mean, New Jersey has several nuclear plants, mm-hmm. but what people may not realize, in 2018, the Oyster Creek nuclear plant was forced to shut down because the state ordered Exelon to install cooling towers, which would have cost billions of dollars to do. And Exelon said, well, given that the plant's license only goes another 10 years, this isn't worth it. We'll never get the money back. So they just shut it down, and environmentalists were delighted. You've got two more nuclear plants, I think Hope Creek and the other name is
Salem.
Salem, thank you. Their licenses start expiring, and they've already been relicensed by the National Nuclear Regulatory Commission in 2036 through 2046. So, you know, and if environmentalists really are smart, then they should be advocating nuclear power. And some environmentalists have realized that, hey, we have to have nukes. We can't just rely on wind and solar. Nuclear, because it's 24/7, is the most reliable form of electricity there is.
Let's just flip back then to natural gas in just terms of infrastructure. You know, we talk about how there are millions of miles of pipeline throughout this country, and you know, 75% of New Jersey households heat their homes, run their stoves, all of that based on natural gas. And there's a lack of willingness from the current government to put any money behind infrastructure repair, which means a lot more of that is going to be transported open road trucks. Can you just talk briefly about what's the difference in terms of human safety and pollution between having trucks transport natural gas versus the pipelines?
Well, it's obviously much more risky to have a truck or train transporting natural gas or oil than a pipeline. People, when the Keystone pipeline was canceled by the Biden administration, the permit again, what people didn't seem to realize that all that oil is going to get, crude oil from Alberta is going to get extracted anyway. It's just going to be delivered down here via rail and truck, and it's going to be shipped off, more of it will be shipped off to China. So not only will it be less safe, there'll be a higher likelihood of oil spills from accidents, but actually emissions will go up because, well, it's a more inefficient way of moving the crude oil, and you're moving it farther. You're going to move a lot of it to China. So, you know, in terms of why this is a victory for the environment, you got me. When it makes pollution worse and it's riskier in terms of spills, how that's a victory for the environment, well, I don't know. And you'll see the same thing in New Jersey. If you ban pipelines, you've seen it in New York State and around New York City. Well, because they can't build any new natural gas pipelines, to get enough natural gas to customers, it has to be shipped generally by truck. They have to move it to distribution areas, truck it in. Not only is that very costly, it's dangerous.
Can you speak to California? Our governor, Governor Murphy, is fond of talking about, his campaign staff talked about it. It was one of the things that he ran on, as insane as it sounds to many of us, to reflect some of the great policies, in their words, of the state of California. But we know California has had energy troubles. What do you attribute that to in terms of a comparison? You know, the blackouts and the brownouts that Californians go through.
Well, California relies very heavily on solar power and, to a smaller extent, wind power. California, you cannot build any new generating plants in California. You've already seen San Onofre, a nuclear plant, shut down. And PG&E is shutting down its Diablo Canyon plant in 2025 because of environmental opposition to that plant's continued operation. So not only are emissions going to increase, but what happens is you get so much solar power generated during the day in, you know, the desert areas of California, that the grid can't handle it because there's not enough demand during the middle of the day. You know, demand for electricity peaks when people get home from work at night, you know, you turn the lights on, and in the early morning. Well, guess what? In the early morning and at night, there is no solar power. So rather than have any, you know, the electricity is being generated at precisely the wrong time. And California calls this something called, it's called the duck curve. I guess it looks like a duck for some reason. And so when there's clouds, you don't get the solar. Well, they don't have enough. California relies very heavily on the imports of electricity. It relies on electricity, hydroelectric power imported from the Pacific Northwest. And it relies on coal and natural gas generated power from, you know, Arizona, Nevada, and Wyoming. They don't like to talk about that. But the reason you get blackouts is there's two reasons. One, you don't have enough renewable power to meet demand, and there's very little battery storage. California wants to increase that, but I mean, it's incredibly expensive. And then you have a problem like in the last California blackout, you had some clouds over the desert. Well, when your entire electric system and reliability depends on what's today's weather forecast, that's not a very reliable power system. And it's especially ironic when the policies are calling for switching everything to electricity. Get rid of your natural gas furnaces, get rid of your natural gas water heaters, your stoves, make all vehicles electric. the importance of reliable electric supplies goes up and up. And yet you start relying on wind and solar power, which is intermittent. It makes no sense. And so what they're going to have to do is build huge quantities of battery storage, which is currently, it's simply not affordable. And the other thing, you know, people will say, well, battery costs are going down. Well, they have come down. But, you know, Tesla, for example, just raised the price of its vehicles last month.
Mm-hmm.
What these people never consider when they just, again, extrapolate curves that show battery costs dropping forever is basic economics. Excuse me, supply and demand. Well, when you force people to buy electric vehicles and you talk about massive increases, battery storage, you need a hell of a lot more batteries. So the demand for batteries is going to just skyrocket. Well, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, and how do they make these batteries? I'd like to understand, is that something, I mean, I've heard some criticisms of the batteries saying that what the environmentalists don't understand is that even in the creation of these batteries, you are actually increasing your output of pollutants.
Sure. Well, for a typical 1,000-pound vehicle battery, my Manhattan Institute colleague, Mark Mills, determined that it takes about 100,000 pounds of raw materials. Now, wow. That's most of that is being mined overseas because environmentalists don't want any mining in the country. And you have a lot of specialized minerals like, you have to mine lithium. Cobalt, for example, is primarily coming from the Congo in Africa, where they use child labor and slave labor. The employment conditions are simply horrible. China produces most of the world's rare earth metals. Those are used in batteries. They're also used in solar and wind turbines. So, you know, and those places have, compared to us, their environmental standards are extremely lax. So basically what environmentalists are saying is, well, if the pollution is somewhere in somebody else's backyard, we don't care. Well, that strikes me as somewhat hypocritical. Toyota has said, the head of Toyota Motor, that's the largest automaker in the world, has said, you cannot meet if all these electric vehicle mandates, there simply isn't enough electricity to power it. It can't happen. They've looked at the numbers and said, these just don't add up. And similarly with the materials for all, you know, once you start saying, we're going to have hundreds of millions of electric vehicles, we're going to electrify everything, we're going to have tons and tons of battery storage facilities, there's, you know, the material costs alone are going to skyrocket because there's no technological advances really occurring in mining and metal processing. So yes, the battery technology may be getting better, but you still use a lot of raw material and that still costs money. And as you increase the demand for all these batteries, well, what are the suppliers going to do? They're going to raise prices.
Mm-hmm.
Of course they will.
So what's the solution as we wrap up? Maybe if there's some takeaway especially for young people who are listening, everything you're saying is grounded in science and fact and the reality of the economy. But if you bring these things up, you either get called a polluter, a climate denier, and anything in between, a crackpot, a quack. You know, these ideas are often dismissed and young people tend to just accept what they're told because it sounds good that we'll live in some fantasy world of a car that gets you to the hospital in under 5 minutes and it won't pollute the environment ever. And people think, what's wrong with that? If we could, that sounds great. We know it's not practical, but what do you say to someone? How do you deal with this with people that you encounter that want to dismiss you as not credible?
Well, I guess what I would tell people, especially kids in school, college kids, people just starting out as one, don't give in to the panic. It's being hyped. The panic, whether it's climate change, whether it's the double mutant COVID-19 variant that the press is starting to, it's that sells papers and eyeballs. That's all they want to do.
It's clicks.
The other thing is start asking some basic questions. For example, we've been told that we can't let temperatures rise more than 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels. Well, why is it? Well, one, what's pre-industrial? When is that? What time period is that? Depends who you ask, actually. And why was the temperature optimal then? We were just coming out of the little ice age, or a mini ice age in the 1700s. George Washington crossed the Delaware because it was frozen over at Christmas. Right. So why was that temperature optimal? What does that even mean for the Earth? So, and a lot of the other thing about climate models, people should realize they're models. One famous scientist said, I can make a model tie my shoes. Because, it depends what you put in. You can make it say anything. And I've been a modeler. I know that. If you look at all these forecasts of impending doom, ask yourself and ask the people, pushing this stuff, well, how accurate are those models? How accurate have they been predicting actual observed temperatures? Turns out they're not accurate at all. So again, well, if that's, if you're a forecaster like I was to start my career, if my model, my forecast model can't even reproduce actual data I have, then my model is garbage. It's not, I'm not going to use it to predict something that's happening in 100 years. It's useless. So, ask them to explain it. The Roman Empire thrived when actually CO2 levels and temperatures were higher than they are today. Why is that? Why weren't they all, dying? What happened then? So, and people try to, the advocates for the panic try to just ignore all that stuff. And it's just ask basic questions rather than believing all of it. It's reasonable to say, yeah, but what about this and this and this? Don't, again, the most important thing is don't give in to the panic porn.
I love it. You said a great thing, though, Doc. You're right. They can barely predict the weather tomorrow, but they can tell you where we're going to be in 100 years.
Sure. Yeah.
With absolute certainty, right? Well, Doc, always great to talk to you. We've been talking with Dr. Jonathan Lesser, who is working with Affordable Energy New Jersey and has written and researched extensively the impact of the governor's master plan, which still out of Trenton, we have no cost associated with it, but we can add a multi-billion-dollar price tag that's going to certainly hurt the average working and middle-class New Jerseyan, making energy less accessible and less affordable. He is also an adjunct fellow at the Manhattan Institute, and we'll certainly have him back on again. Doc, thank you. Always great. Great to see you.
Thanks for having me, Bill. I appreciate it.
We'll see you next month. Take care.
Bye-bye.